Now that your laughter has subsided, perhaps I may ask you a question. I wonder what images the word Arctic conjures up in your mind. Icebergs, perhaps, of various shapes and sizes. Or beautiful Eskimo or Inuit children. Or maybe 5 million square miles of treeless tundra. Or perhaps it is the wildlife, for example, the glaucous gull, which never leaves the Arctic and has almost transparent wings. Or again, the sleek Arctic wolf, which the Inuit call Amaruk. And certainly we know that the Arctic is the land of the midnight sun, which in the summer never drops below the horizon. My first visit to the frozen north was in 1973. It began in Churchill on the western shore of Hudson Bay and concluded at Bathurst Inlet Lodge in the center of the map. My birdwatching companion on this trip was Gordon Johnson, now Professor of Ophthalmology at University College London, while his wife Anne, a pediatrician, and their 9-month-old son David joined us later at Bathurst Inlet Lodge. When we arrived in Churchill, Hudson Bay had not yet completely thawed, and the spruce trees were an indication that we were still in the sub-Arctic zone. Hudsonian godwits liked to perch precariously on the topmost twigs, and the lesser yellowlegs looked distinctly ungainly and uncomfortable, while the short-billed dowitcher was sensible enough to stay in its natural habitat on the ground and at the water's edge. To reach Bathurst Inlet Lodge, just north of the Arctic Circle, we flew from Yellowknife on a DC-3. Our destination was that little cluster of buildings at the mouth of the Burnside River. Bathurst Inlet Lodge, spelled out in caribou antlers, was originally a Hudson Bay trading post. Then, in 1935, it became a Roman Catholic mission. But in 1964, the abandoned buildings were bought by Glenn Warner, a former Royal Canadian Mounted Policeman. Glenn and Trish have done a marvelous job converting the place into a lodge during the brief Arctic summer for birdwatchers and other wildlife enthusiasts. For all around is a magnificent panorama of tundra, hills, lakes, and sea, with the nearest other human habitation some 50 to 60 miles away. Next door to the lodge is a group of government-supplied, prefabricated fiberglass igloos, in which about 25 Inuit live. They are partners in the enterprise with Glenn and Trish. So let me now introduce their leaders to you. This is Mary Tapana, the matriarch of the whole community. And here is John, her husband, the senior man. Together, Mary and John make a fine couple of leaders, impressive in their caribou skin clothing. John is a very skilled fisherman. For Arctic char, a species of salmon, sliced and hung up to dry in the summer, is one of the community's staple foods during the winter. A young boy visitor tried his hand at fishing, but caught nothing, which is not altogether surprising, as he was only 5 years old. Alongside Mary and John lived the next three generations, including their great-grandchildren, who loved to play with the husky pups. During the 2.5 months of Arctic summer, the ice and snow melt, and the wild flowers come out. God's garden, I like to call it. Here are mountain avens, or Arctic dryas, a member of the rose family, and the floral emblem of Canada's Northwest Territories, and Arctic lupins. and purple saxifrage. And here is white alpine saxifrage. While this is the elegant Indian paintbrush and the dainty little Arctic poppy. Every day, we went off on an expedition by boat. A favorite destination was the narrow gorge whose waters fed the Burnside River and at one point created a mighty waterfall. It was here that, high up the gorge's precipitous cliffs, a pair of gyr falcons had built their eyrie. They are authentic birds of the far north. Gyr falcons feed on Arctic ground squirrel, or the siksik, as the Inuit call them on account of their rather metallic chatter. Gyr falcons like ptarmigan too, which lose their white plumage in the summer months. On my first visit to Bathurst Inlet Lodge, I found myself appointed the honorary chaplain to the Inuit community. So, in fulfillment of my chaplaincy duties, I officiated at several weddings. Here are Peter, Mary's grandson, and Martina. While here are Robert and Martha, the bride wearing a charming coronet of wild Arctic rhododendrons. Later, I had the joy of baptizing their babies. This is Tommy Agnakyuk. And this is Connie, daughter of Joseph and Mary Kanyak, who were camping nearby. But alongside joy came pain. For Jacob Avadluk, the 19-year-old Inuk by the waterfall, went swimming the following day and unaccountably drowned. There was no undertaker, of course, nor any of the trappings of a Western funeral, but the local RCMP flew in from Cambridge Bay, some 250 miles away, to certify the death. That evening, I was asked to officiate at the funeral. It was a most moving occasion. But as I proclaimed the words of Jesus, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, though he dies," the whole sky seemed to respond in a blaze of orange glory. Let me now introduce you to some of the other birds which breed in the Arctic. Here is the lovely little Lapland longspur. And this is the rather rare yellow-billed loon. The female eiderduck actually plucks eiderdown from her breast with which to line her nest. While the Arctic terns perform the astonishing feat of flying down to the southern tip of Africa for the winter, a journey there and back of about 20,000 miles every year. By contrast, here is the familiar American robin, which we were very surprised to find so far north. Caribou, which are the reindeer of North America, also migrate south for the winter, although only to the forests of southern Canada. Caribou are the Inuit's best friends, for they supply them with food, clothing, and blankets. They are powerful swimmers, which is when they are most vulnerable to the gun. One day when I was there, the Inuit shot 12 and brought them home by boat. Immediately Jessie, Mary's daughter, began to cut up the caribou meat with her razor-sharp Ulu knife. The other large mammal of the Arctic tundra is the majestic muskox. We were lucky to stumble across a small herd in the pasture. The muskox is a prehistoric relic from the last ice age. In those far-off days, it roamed over much of Europe and Asia, as well as America. At the beginning of this century, however, it was almost extinct. but since 1917 they have been protected by law so that they are now no longer an endangered species. The musk ox, or umingmuk, the bearded one, as the Inuit call it, can endure the bitterest Arctic winter because it has two coats, a thick, shaggy overcoat and an undergarment of silky wool, warmer even than cashmere. Musk oxen are wild, shy creatures, so when one turned to face me and began to snort and paw the ground, I knew the time had come to make a prudent retreat. Our most exciting experience while at Bathurst Inlet Lodge was an expedition in the Cessna on floats, some 250 miles east into the uninhabited tundra. We flew over a maze of coloured lakes, until at last we reached Lake Carrick, on whose islands the white geese, which are only white dots in this picture, were known to breed. As we came down, snow geese were flying all around us, snow white, as indeed their name implies, except for their black wingtips. There has always been something romantic about these birds, at least since the publication of Paul Gallico's famous story, The Snow Goose. A portrait of this handsome bird reveals its rather strange grey horizontal grin. Blue geese were also nesting on the island. They used to be regarded as a separate species, but now are known to be a dark phase of the snow goose. Our main quest, however, was the much rarer Ross's goose, which winters in valleys of central California. In fact, here is one which I photographed some years later in California. The Ross's goose is similar to the snow goose, but it's smaller and it lacks the facial grin. We were distressed when, at our approach, all the geese got up off their nest and began to walk away from us. But one bird stayed put, and we soon learned why. It was her gorgeous golden gosling. After hatching, the gosling stays in the nest for only about 24 hours, so we were lucky to arrive just when the hatching was taking place. One gosling, which had already left the nest, fixated on Gordon Johnson, and he had considerable difficulty in severing the relationship. The bonding between mother and chick was much more healthy. In a rusty old tin can, on the left of the picture, hidden in a cairn at one end of the island, we found this message, which had been left in 1965 by Professor John Ryder, who claims to have discovered this breeding colony, and so he named it Lake Carrick after the Inuit name of the Ross's goose. We were probably the first human beings to visit the lake for 8 years. Despite my 4 visits to Bathurst Inlet Lodge as its honorary chaplain, I had still not seen a snowy owl. But in 1986, I had the opportunity to go further north to Frobisher Bay, Resolute, and Little Cornwallis Island. Would I see the fabulous isle this time? Steve Andrews, one of my former study assistants, joined me on this expedition. Frobisher Bay, now called Iqaluit, is the headquarters of the Anglican Diocese of the Arctic, and this is St. Jude's Cathedral, built to resemble an igloo. On the average cathedral close, one can expect to find sparrows, but St. Jude's Cathedral was favoured with snow buntings. The male is pure white, apart from some black on the wing, and in flight it looks like a random snowflake. The interior of the cathedral is decorated with Inuit art, and the communion rails consist of 2 sleds or toboggans on their side. Colourful cloth banners on the east wall depict typical scenes of both Inuit family life and of Arctic wildlife, The font has been carved out of a beautiful block of green soapstone and was presented by Her Majesty the Queen when she visited Frobisher in 1970. While the black cross is adorned with the spiral tusks of the narwhal whale, sometimes referred to as the unicorn of the ocean. The Dean of the Cathedral is Mike Gardiner, a veteran of the Arctic and a devoted pastor. He translated my Sunday sermon into Inuktitut. Mike was assisted by two Inuit lay readers. And here are a mother and her baby, who were part of the Sunday morning Inuit congregation of about 300. Frobisher Bay itself was still frozen, and there were hardly any birds to be seen anywhere. But Jimmy Papazzi, leader of the cathedral youth group, who had a healthy team of five huskies, the lead dog being the mother of the other four, took us on an exhilarating sled expedition. The dogs pulled us over the frozen bay at a fine speed. Our flight to Resolute took us over a vast expanse of ice, intersected by channels of blue water. Although Resolute has only 200 inhabitants, it has its own little Anglican church. Outside several houses, polar bear skins were stretched on frames to dry in the sun. Our most fascinating sight was a giant iceberg, which had floated down from Ellesmere Island in the far north. We visited it by snowmobile shortly before midnight, as it towered at least 100 feet above us. Another day we flew to so-called Beachy Island, which is actually a peninsula at the southwest tip of Devon Island. It's a historic site in relation to Sir John Franklin's 19th century expeditions in search of the Northwest Passage. His third was fatal, for he and his whole crew of 128 officers and men perished. Numerous ships were dispatched to look for them, and at last one found some equipment and graves on Beachy Island, seen in the background, where Franklin and his men spent the winter of 1845-46. So, a monument was erected in that desolate spot to commemorate both Franklin's crew and those who died while searching for them. Close by, we found four graves where some of Franklin's men were buried. The most legible inscription commemorates John Torrington, who died aged 20 on the 18th of January, 1846. His body has recently been disinterred, having been perfectly preserved in that natural refrigerator. Rod Douglas joined Steve and me at Resolute, having been vice president for field operations of Cominco, the consolidated mining company. He has an extensive knowledge of the Arctic. He kindly arranged for the three of us to stay at Polaris Mine on Little Cornwallis Island. It's the most northerly metal mine in the world, extracting lead and zinc from ore. We were taken underground one day, clad in orange-brown dungarees and hard hats, and were very impressed by the whole operation. Above ground again, we were amazed that a hairy caterpillar could survive in that intense cold. An Arctic fox, which had molted about half its white winter coat, was in hot pursuit of something it could smell. And it took a rather unwelcome fancy to us. From Polaris Mine, we flew further north still to Polar Bear Pass on Bathurst Island, not far south of the magnetic North Pole. From the air, we could just about make out the huts on that small and barren plateau in the middle of the picture. Here, in 1968, some Canadian scientists from Ottawa set up their High Arctic Research Station. All round us was the great white wilderness, about 7,000 uninhabited square miles. The genius behind the research station is Stu MacDonald, a biologist and ornithologist of world renown. He's well known for this picture, which he took, of an aggressive ivory gull whose breeding grounds he discovered in the high Arctic. Each day, we went on an expedition, often by snowmobile and sled. There were no signs of spring flowers yet, only brightly colored lichens. So here are your three Arctic explorers, wrapped up against a temperature of several degrees below zero. One commodity of which there was no shortage was water, since we used melted snow. Very few birds had arrived yet, but three brent geese in procession delighted us. They winter in Northern Ireland. On other days we sallied forth on foot, still hoping against hope for a snowy owl. Instead, we came across a snow den of, what do you think? Of Arctic hare, still in their pure white fur coats. They were also unbelievably tame. The main subject of Stu MacDonald's research was the rock ptarmigan, a circumpolar grouse, the same species as the Scottish ptarmigan. This is a female, her white winter coat already flecked with brown. And here's another, almost entirely brown. In contrast, the male still had his immaculate white plumage. His red comb adds to his distinction, especially when he inflates it in courtship display or in aggression. The nearest we got to a polar bear was its fresh footprints in the snow. Our main compensation for not seeing either a polar bear or a snowy owl was a shy Arctic wolf, which, attracted by smells emanating from our kitchen, gave us an unusual sight of its graceful elegance. As the twin otter flew in to fetch us, we promised ourselves another Arctic expedition, in undiminished pursuit of the ever-elusive snowy owl. It's 1991 now, and to celebrate my 70th birthday, some friends and I planned a visit to Cambridge Bay on Victoria Island, while 5 years later I visited Saxe Harbour to the west and returned to Cambridge Bay. Cambridge Bay is one of the main locations of the so-called dew line, or distance early warning system, which straddles the frozen north. Cambridge Bay is also great for birds. Here, for example, is the lovely red phalarope. In response to our numerous inquiries about snowy owls, we were directed to Mount Pelly, which you can see on the horizon. So here, we pitched our tents. David Spence, president of the Langham Foundation, is in the middle of the picture. And on the right are Rod Douglas, in his red cap, and his doctor friend, Morley Phillips. On our first day there, Rod caught a delicious 2-pound Arctic char, which we had for our supper. Walking round the base of Mount Pelly, we found a nesting tundra swan. You'll agree it's a very handsome creature, and Morley spent the whole night in the hide, which we had erected near the nest. Another bird we enjoyed was the red-throated loon, or red-throated diver, as we call it in Britain. We pitched our tent hide close to its island nest. And we had the joy of watching it return to the nest and resume incubation. The American golden plover is another Arctic breeder, but believe it or not, it winters as far south as Australia. Similar to the golden plover, but arguably more beautiful, is the grey or black-bellied plover, this one being lit by the midnight sun. These are colourful king eider drakes. We were lucky to see them just before they left land for the open sea. During the short summer, most of the Inuit move out of Cambridge Bay to their fishing camp by the seashore, and this is the tent frame in which we spent a night. Outside, glaucous gulls were standing on the melting ice. We also saw all three species of skua, or jaeger. This is the pomerine with its strangely twisted tail. While this is the long-tailed skua here on its nest, and here in magnificent flight. Skuas are very aggressive towards anybody who intrudes into their territory, as Morley Phillips found to his cost. But still, no snowy owl, no ukpik, as the Inuit call it. We caught a momentary glimpse of one in flight at a distance of about a quarter of a mile, but that was not good enough. We found no nest. How then could I finish my slide sequence without this anticipated climax? I had an idea. I telephoned the London Zoo. Yes, indeed, they said, they had a pair of snowy owls. I found that the female was quite presentable, but the male was a poor old fellow, 45 years old, suffering from a double cataract. I thought he would never do for the climax. So I just had to return to the beauties of the Arctic tundra to make a final attempt to find and photograph a nesting pair of snowy owls. The chance came in 1996 to celebrate my 75th birthday. This is Sachs Harbour, a little hamlet of 125 people, the only human settlement on Banks Island, the most westerly of the Arctic islands. The mayor of Sachs, Peter Esau by name, welcomed us. That is Steve Andrews, now Dean of the Cathedral in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, and me. And he was extremely hospitable to us throughout our stay. There's an Anglican church in Sachs, but no resident minister. In fact, they hadn't had a Sunday service for 2 or 3 years. So Roger Kuptana, an elder, had agreed that if we got ourselves to Sachs and conducted 2 Sunday services, we would be given free board and lodging. He also lent us this all-terrain vehicle on which Steve and I crisscrossed the surrounding tundra each day. The Kuptana family took us out one evening on a seal hunt, which brought us some 7 miles out to the ice floe. As the flowers were already over on the tundra, we had to be content with the brightly coloured lichens, some orange-red, and others bright yellow. Birds were scarce too, though we did find and photograph this rough-legged hawk's nest. But where were the nesting snowy owls? Our best hope, we were told, would be Cambridge Bay, Ikaluktutik, as it is called, the fair fishing place. It was good to be back there, to enjoy familiar landmarks, like the wreck of the 3-masted schooner, the Maud, For 7 years, from 1918 to 25, she served under the famous explorer Amundsen in the Arctic. But in 1931, she was abandoned and sank soon afterwards. In charge of St. George's Anglican Mission in Cambridge Bay is Keith Todd, a former All Souls member. He and his wife, Barb, have 3 delightful children, and they were incredibly kind in their welcome. Outside the town was a nesting colony of the seldom-seen Sabine's gull, but they come to land only to breed and spend the rest of the year in the open seas of the southern hemisphere. Now, this little fellow, the lemming, is the chief actor in the drama of the snowy owl. The lemmings are their chief diet. When lemmings abound, owls abound. But when lemmings are few, owls are few too. Here is Kevin Smart, director of renewable resources at Cambridge Bay and a keen bird watcher. He gave us the good news that it was an excellent lemming year. And Kevin found this nest in the tundra. You can see it in the foreground, surrounded by protective rocks. When we first inspected the nest, it contained 7 eggs and 1 newly hatched chick, so it was here that we set up our hide. I didn't have to wait long before the female, who does all the incubating, flew back to her nesting site. Landing a little way away, she half hopped, half flew to the nest itself. And then came long hours of patient sitting and incubating. Every 2 or 3 hours, the male would fly in with a fresh lemming, and there would be a lemming transfer ceremony. Then he would fly off, and she would take the lemming and feed it to her chicks. After a few days, several eggs had hatched, and the chicks were hungry for food. After a good meal, they were placid and evidently quite content. So life went on, as I continued for many hours to eavesdrop on the comings and goings at the nest. So I hope you will join me in celebrating this sensational bird and the fulfillment of my 23-year-long quest.